The Cat by E.F. Benson, narrated by Trevor O'Hare. Many people will doubtless remember that exhibition at the Royal Academy, not so many seasons ago, which came to be known as Alingman's Year, when Dick Alingman vaulted, with one bound, as it were, out of the crowd of strugglers, and seated himself with admirably certain poise on the very topmost pinnacle of contemporary fame. He exhibited three portraits, each a masterpiece, which killed every picture within range. But since that year, nobody cared anything for pictures, whether in or out of range, except those three. It did not signify so greatly. The phenomenon of his appearance was as sudden as that of a meteor, coming from nowhere and sliding large and luminous across the remote and star-sown sky, as inexplicable as the bursting of a spring on some dust-ridden rocky hillside. Some fairy godmother, one might conjecture, had bethought herself of her forgotten godson, and with a wave of her wand bestowed on him this transcendent gift. But, as the Irish say, she held her wand in her left hand, for her gift had another side to it. Or perhaps, again, Jim Merwick is right, in the theory he propounds in his monograph on certain obscure lesions of the nerve centers, says the final word on the subject. Dick Alingman himself, as was indeed natural, was delighted with his fairy godmother or his obscure lesion, whichever was responsible, and the monograph spoken of above was written after Dick's death, confessed frankly to his friend Merwick, who was still struggling through the crowd of rising young medical practitioners, that it was all quite as inexplicable to himself as it was to anyone else. "All I know about it," he said, "is that last autumn I went through 2 months of mental depression so hideous that I thought again and again that I must go off my head. For hours daily I sat here, waiting for something to crack, which as far as I am concerned would end everything. Yes, there was a cause, you know it." He paused for a moment and poured into his glass a fairly liberal allowance of whiskey, filled it up half from a siphon and a lit cigarette. The cause, indeed, had no need to be enlarged on, for Merwick quite well remembered how the girl Dick had been engaged to threw him over with an abruptness that was almost superb when a more eligible suitor made his appearance. The latter was certainly very eligible indeed with his good looks, his title, and his million of money, and Lady Mattingly, ex-future Mrs. Alingham, was perfectly content with what she had done. She was one of those blonde, lithe, silken girls who, happily for the peace of men's minds, are rather rare, and who remind one of some humanized yet celestial and bestial cat. "I needn't speak of the cause," Dick continued, "but, as I say, for those 2 months I soberly thought that the only end to it would be madness. Then one evening, when I was sitting here alone, I was always sitting alone, something did snap in my head. I know I wondered, without caring at all, whether this was the madness which I had been expecting, or whether, which would be preferable, some more fatal breakage had happened. And even while I wondered, I was aware that I was not depressed or unhappy any longer." He paused for so long in a smiling retrospect that Merwick indicated to him that he had a listener. "Well," he said, "it was well indeed. I haven't been unhappy since. I have been riotously happy instead. Some divine doctor, I suppose, just wiped off that stain on my brain that hurt so. Heavens, how it hurt. Have a drink, by the way?" "No thanks," said Merwick. "But what has all this got to do with your painting?" "Why, everything. For I had hardly realized the fact that I was happy again when I was aware that everything looked different. The colors of all I saw were twice as vivid as they had been, shape and outline were intensified too. The whole visible world had been dusty and blurred before, and seen in a half light, but now the lights were turned up, and there was a new heaven and a new earth. And in the same flash, I knew that I could paint things as I saw them, which," he concluded, "I have done." There was something rather sublime about this, and Merwick laughed. "I wish something would snap in my brain, if it kindles the perceptions in that way," said he. "But it is just possible that the snapping of things in one's brain does not always produce just that effect." "That is possible. Also, as I gather, things don't snap unless you've gone through some such hideous period as I have been through. And I tell you frankly that I wouldn't go through that again, even to ensure a snap that would make..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.